Hello friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Today, let's see the current affairs of 1st September 2018. The articles we'll be covering today are these seven. Let's see them all in detail now. The first article is about the sedition debate. It appeared in today's newspaper's editorial. Session 124A of Indian Penal Code, it talks about the provisions of sedition existing in our country. And this provision 124A of IPC exists from the colonial rule. It was basically brought in order to curb freedom struggle movement against the Britishers. And this is existing in the law books even today. And there are many instances in the recent past which has misused this clause of Indian Penal Code. And so this misuse calls for a recall of this section. For example, both the state and the center has used this IPC 124A against many rights activists, writers and even cartoonists in the past couple of years. And this is a very serious situation as it stands against the right to equality and the freedom of speech, which is a part of fundamental rights of Indian Constitution. And the Law Commission of India, for the third time in the past five decades, has called for the process of revisiting this session 124A of IPC. So the first biggest question here regarding this provision is, this provision was brought in during the British to suppress the freedom struggle. But even the British itself has abolished this session in their country 10 years ago. Why then it still exists in our country? This question needs to be addressed now. Another serious concern about this provision is, the sedition in IPC definition is very wide. It is wide in the sense that, under the present existing law of IPC, any strong criticism against the government policies or any government personalities, like raising voices against the government policies or raising voices against the personalities connected with the government, these are called to be insidious and they can be treated as a crime under IPC 124. And this provision under IPC 124 is considered regardless of whether the situation may be resulting in actual incitement of violence and threatening public order or not. Regardless of that, it is considered as a crime in our country. Supreme Court in the recent past has said that this provision of sedition should be applied only when there is incitement to violence or tendency to create public disorder, that is, instability must be there in order to apply this provision of IPC. However, regardless of this stand of Supreme Court, this sedition provision has been applied to several other cases where there is no threat to public order. So it is highly essential that in a world's largest democracy like India, the IPC sedition definition must be narrowed down, or in a better way, the whole session needs to be taken away altogether. The second article we are going to see today is Submerging Markets on Falling Rupee Value. It has been repeatedly in news that the value of rupee against dollar has been falling for past couple of weeks, and this is a very high issue. And Indian rupee has weakened in the past to rupees 71 mark for the first time yesterday. And this is about 10% loss of its value against dollar when comparison to the beginning of this year 2018. And with this fall, it makes rupee the worst performing currency in whole of Asia. And it is also to be noted that it's not only the rupee which is falling against dollar. This trend is visible in several other developing economies too. For example, it is evident in Turkish currency lira, Argentina's currency peso, and South African currency rand. All of these currencies, they are also falling against dollar. And this, apart from the domestic reasons existing in these countries, it is also due to the loss of confidence among the investors investing in these countries. One of the important reasons for the fall of the currencies of many developing countries like India and South Africa is due to increasing demand of dollar across the globe. And this can be attributed to tightening of liquidity in the West, especially with US Federal Reserves, they hiked the interest rates. So this will lead to strengthening of dollar and it will in turn affect the other currencies across the globe. This policy of US Federal Reserves of tightening the interest rates, it indicates that the dollar is becoming stronger again. So this will make the investors to trust the dollar more when compared to emerging markets, and the investors will invest more in American assets, which will give them more in compared to investing in domestic currencies. And apart from the reasons, many developing countries are also suffering from the problem of inflation in the domestic markets when compared to other countries in the West. This is also a reason for fall in the currencies of many developing countries. And it is high time that the central banks of the developing countries take this situation seriously and bring in many reforms to restore the value of rupee against dollar. The third article we are going to see today is India and US, it is complicated. It is a very big article, and this article is divided into three parts. The first part deals with the evolution of relationship between India and US, and the second part deals with the problems existing in the relationship between India and US, and the last part it suggests for why there needs to be a solution to address this problem. So let's get into the article. So the first round of India-US 2+2 talks is scheduled to happen this month. This 2+2 is the External Affairs Minister and Defense Minister of India and their counterparts from US. They are going to meet and discuss the relationship between India and US progress. And this 2+2 meet is a very significant development in relationship between both the countries. On one hand, India is the world's largest democracy, and other hand, US is the world's oldest democracy. And this relationship is definitely a very significant development on this front. So there are three important factors which has contributed to the significant emerging strategic convergence between India and US. Let's see the first factor. By the end of Cold War between US and Russia, it provided the opportunity for both the countries to review the relationship on the changing global and regional realities. So after the Cold War, India was able to establish friendly relationship with both USA and Russia without any apprehensions. With that as a first step, the second important step between the relationship of India and US is opening up of Indian economy. This opening up of Indian economy has led to American private sector taking a look into India, and they came to invest in India, showing a very greater interest. And today, because of this, the trade grew multifold between India and US. For example, today the trade between India and US, it stands more than $120 billion a year, and we also have a very ambitious target of achieving $500 billion a year in coming 5 years. And the relationship between India and US in trade front is not just one-sided. The foreign direct investment from US to India is more than $20 billion. And however, Indian companies have also invested in US for more than $15 billion. So this is a two-side relationship rather than being a unilateral one. So this trade has also benefited in India and US relationship. The third factor, it talks about the 3 million strong Indian diaspora, they're living in US. We all know that India has significant amount of Indian persons of Indian origin or non-resident Indians living in US. And this has influenced even the US Congress with supporters of India and non-supporters of India. And yet, in spite of these three areas progress, the engagement has still not been a smooth sailing. There exist still some complexities between the relationship between India and US. So let's see what are the complexities in the relationship. The first sector we'll be seeing is defense. So the defense dialogue between India and US, it started way back in 1995 with the setting up of all new defense policy group at the level of defense secretary in our country. So after this, that is after a decade later, in 2005, this agreement was formalized and it even was enlarged, which was renewed for even further 10 years in the year 2015. Today, apart from these agreements, India and US, they also conduct many military exercises together, and these military exercises, they gradually evolved in scale and complexity. For example, the exercises like Malabar are conducted between India, Japan and China every year. And in 2016, India was designated as major defense partner of US. And another very important step in evolving relationship in defense sector between India and US is, in the middle of the year, an inclusion of India in strategic trade authorization, that is STA1 category, was given to India. This means that The US has put India on par with other allies in terms of the technology access given to India. And this is a very significant step, especially in the digital economy of current 21st century. So now let's see what are the obligations and the challenges that exist between the relationship between India and US. And the first is about the agreement which was in news for the past couple of years, which is called as Communication Compatibility and Security Agreement. This agreement was proposed by US and it is with respect to the logistic area. It is a logistic support agreement which was initiated by US in 2003 and it was finally concluded only in the year 2006 with certain amendments making it more friendly towards India. And it facilitates logistic supplies during port visits and joint exercises. That is, if Indian ships or US ship visit each other's country, then they can use the port facilities for refueling, etc. However, it is also to be noted that this agreement does not talk about any joint activity or creating any base for both the countries in each other's place. The second important problem or obstacle between India and US is another agreement called as CAATSA. That is Countering America's Adversaries Through Sanctions Act. It is an act of USA Parliament and it was enacted last year. And according to the act, the USA designates certain countries as adversaries to USA. And if India has any relationship with such an adversary to US, then India is susceptible to the sanctions from US. And Russian military and Russian intelligence entities are listed according to this Sanctions Act. And if India engages with this Russian intelligence entities or military entities, then USA may impose sanctions on India. And this is a very major challenge. However, there has been a waiver provision included in order to cover India, Vietnam and Indonesia. That is to exclude India from this CAATSA Act. However, this is a very serious challenge and it needs to be addressed as soon as possible. And the third obstacle between India and US relationship is the factor of Iran. We all know about the US sanctions on Iran after Iran's unilateral withdrawal from the nuclear deal. And the Iran's crude imports have grown significantly in the recent years when with respect to India. And India has also supported Iran in development of Chabahar port. So Chabahar port is located here and this Chabahar port will establish connectivity with India and Afghanistan and central India and it is a very strategically important location for India. So if US is making any changes in with respect to Iran, it will definitely affect the India's investment in Iran and its relationship with the US. So all these situations need to be taken into consideration in the coming 2+2 dialogue. And solutions must be brought in for peaceful relationship between India and US. There's also a proposed Asia-Pacific Indian Ocean Region strategic vision, which has been proposed in the year 2015. And in order to achieve the vision of peace and stability in the Indian Ocean region, as proposed in this strategic vision, both the countries will have to enhance the partnership and diplomacy between each other. The fourth article we are going to see today is about the Uniform Civil Code. And this Uniform Civil Code article has been repeated for many months now, and so it can be very important for the exam. So no need for Uniform Civil Code now, says law panel. So the Law Commission of India has taken into consideration the issue of Uniform Civil Code, and it has said that the Uniform Civil Code is neither a necessity nor desirable at this stage in our country. It has also added that a unified nation does not necessarily need to have uniformity. That is, diversity can exist in any united nation and there is no necessity to bring in uniformity in a united nation. So efforts have to be made to reconcile the diversity with universal and indisputable arguments of human rights. So human rights needs to be the principal value for considering Uniform Civil Code rather than giving importance to any particular religion existing in our country. Apart from this, the Law Commission has also proposed several other changes or suggestions. Let's see them. So it has also suggested an important point about the marriage age. The Law Commission has proposed that the minimum legal age for men and women, both of them to get married must be 18. Currently it is 18 only for women and it is 23 for men. And in order for equality to exist between men and women, and also taking into consideration the changing trends in the age of marriage between men and women, the marriageable legal age of men must be reduced to 18. And this is very essential in order to end the stereotype which exists in our country that wives must always be younger than their husbands. And the second change proposed by the Law Commission is with respect to divorce. The Law Commission talks about the right to recognize the role of women in household. So it says that the woman should get an equal part of property when there is an event of divorce. So it recognizes the right of women in a household sector. However, it does not give any absolute equal split of property after divorce. So that will vary according to the each case. The Law Commission also touched upon the factor of polygamy. It has suggested that the Dikumanas to make clear that polygamy is an offence and it should apply to all communities existing in our country. The fifth article we'll be seeing today is GDP grows 8.2% in April-June quarter. That is, Indian economy, it grew about 8.2%. It is the highest in past couple of years when April-June quarter is considered. And there are two main reasons for this robust growth. One is the increased growth of manufacturing sector in our country. And second is the increased growth of construction and the farm sectors in our country. This graph talks about it. So the gross value addition, especially in the manufacturing sector, it went up. And it went up to 13.5% when compared to -1.8% last year. And other important sector is the farm growth or the agricultural growth. It also went about 5.3% increase when compared to last quarter of about 3%. And this figures has increased the hope that India is estimated to post an annual growth rate of more than 7.5% this year. The sixth article we'll be seeing today is with respect to Census 2021. For the first time, Census 2021 to collect data on OBCs. So this will be the first time census data will be collected exclusively for other backward caste people. So this decennial means a census which is conducted once in 10 years. So this process will involve 25 lakh trained people to collect efficient data. The process may also use maps or geo-referencing facilities in order to collect data. This is a proposal which is still under consideration. And this decision to count the OBCs in our current country in 2021 is to get a correct perspective of assessing the social status of OBCs existing in our country. Only if the social status is empirically assessed, then affirmative action can be provided accordingly to the OBCs. And this is very essential for India as it's a democratic and an inclusive country. It is also to be noted that 2011 also collected caste-based data in the form of socio-economic caste census, but the data is yet to be released to the public by the center. And in the earlier notification by Home Ministry, it said that the data collected during 2021 census will also be stored electronically. And if it is stored electronically, it will be the first census data which will be stored electronically. The last news we'll be seeing today is with respect to BIMSTEC. Root out terror, BIMSTEC. So BIMSTEC is Bay of Bengal Initiative for Multi-Sectoral Technical and Economic Cooperation. It is a regional grouping with 7 countries, namely India, Bangladesh, Myanmar, Sri Lanka, Thailand, Bhutan and Nepal. Recently, the 7 leaders of the 7 countries met in Kathmandu, and Kathmandu declaration was adopted by the 7 leaders of the BIMSTEC countries. And one of the very important points in this Kathmandu declaration is their unified call to curb terror. The declaration said that terror is a very great threat across the world and it will disturb international peace and security of not just BIMSTEC countries but all around the globe. So it also emphasized that identifying and holding accountable both the state and the non-state entities which caused the terror is very essential to curb the terror. And it also called for a comprehensive approach across all the nations to curb the terror financing which causes many terror attacks. The Kathmandu Declaration also emphasized the importance of teamwork, especially between the 7 countries, which is very much essential in order to sustain the cooperation to stop the terror attacks in the countries. The BIMSTEC, the Kathmandu Declaration also gave emphasis to connectivity. That is, it said that multidimensional connectivity will be a key enabler in order to establish economic integration and prosperity between the countries. There was also a special MOU signed for the establishment of BIMSTEC grid interconnection to provide energy security between the countries. Thank you.